That's what I'm talking about.
Wait!
Okay, now, from the beginning.
Hi everybody, it's Ollie from Beertown Film Festival here. We just want to say a huge thank you for all of your support this year. It's been a very, very different year by anybody's standard, but we've really tried to put in the effort that we feel was as close to what we'd have got if it hadn't been, you know, last year or the year before. So thank you for all of your support. Thank you for everybody that's come along and watched all of the screenings. It's really been fantastic to see you guys. We just wanted to show you some highlights from our Q&A with Steve, which took place last night. Cheers, guys. Thank you.
Yeah, I mean, actually, I did a short film not very long ago, and I did it for the National Film School, which was, and it was actually an animated fiction film, and I voiced it, and it was a really brilliant piece of work, and a very interesting piece of work, actually. And I wasn't actually in it; I was just doing the voices or a voice of one of the characters,
right.
But I really enjoyed it. And also what I love about short films is that they are not bound by the same convention in a way that a 90 or 120 minute movie can be bound by. You know, that you can tell your story using all sorts of different conventions, which in fact, if you tried that in a 90 or 120 minute movie, it would be confusing or in fact boring. But the conventions that you can use in a short movie to tell a story are fantastic. And absolutely, one of the things that I noticed, certainly in the last 2 years of judging this film festival, is that young filmmakers are really using different styles, different conventions to tell their story.
Yeah.
As you touched on, you know, the quality has improved year after year after year. And that is, of course, because as the festival, you know, becomes better known, mm-hmm, it attracts more filmmakers and better filmmakers.
Absolutely.
But, you know, the quality certainly in this year especially has been quite remarkable, really.
Oh, sure, yeah, we'll go into that a little bit later on, because, you know, we'll talk about how close it was as well, particularly for your category. So we'll dive all into that. Just sticking on kind of you with short films, what kind of, for someone like you who's done, you know, a number of theatre productions, film, TV.
Yeah.
What is it that would attract you to go into a short film? Is it the storyline? Is it the director as such?
Predominantly on a short movie. I mean, you know, my job as an actor is really basically just telling stories. You know, I'm part of a storytelling process. I mean, I love telling stories, and I did when I was a kid, and it partly attracted me to being an actor. Mm-hmm. And I love the storytelling process. And, you know, admittedly, on film, you are just a cog in that storytelling process. So for me, what would attract me to a short film and a short fiction would generally be, you know, the story, but also it would be the director and the producer's vision of it and how they want to tell it. And that is something, you know, my being part of someone else's storytelling process and their vision is a really enjoyable thing. You know, because obviously it involves my own creative process as well, and how I then fit into that storytelling process. But predominantly for me, it's looking at a script and it's the dialogue, the plot and the storyline.
And that's what a short film director should be really putting most of their kind of focus in onto.
I think so. I mean, you know, as I said earlier, the joy of a short film is that you're not bound by the same convention that you are probably in television and or in a longer film. So you can really do something with the conventions that you want to tell the story. And I always find that a really attractive thing. But I always think you have a short period of time to tell that story and you have to be very clever about how you tell it. But often, you know, like this year, I looked at some of those films and the way the story was told was fantastic. And, you know, leading you one way, but at the end of it, giving you something completely different. And I loved that.
There was so many of those this year. So for kind of like younger directors, younger actors who are the guys who are kind of most exposed, this is the most work they're exposed to. How would you kind of like, what kind of advice would you kind of give them and what direction would you point them in with short films?
I mean, the great thing about short movies is basically you can shoot one on an iPhone now, you know, I mean, so, I mean, once upon a time, as you know, in my profession, you know, once upon a time, there was only one way to get into the industry as an actor, and that was through an accredited drama school. You know, that is not the case anymore. And probably the case for young filmmakers, there was one way to get into the filming industry, and it was probably through film school. That is not the case anymore. And certainly, for young filmmakers now, the technology that's available to us, you know, as I said, you can shoot one on an iPhone now, but you know, the technology that's available now for young filmmakers to move forward and get into the industry is amazing. You know, in terms of editing software, in terms of lighting, in terms of what you use to shoot, is much, much easier now to tell your story than it ever was. You know, than it ever was. And you don't need a huge budget to do it anymore.
No, definitely. Because it kind of gives that, I guess, the directors, and you see a load of this at the moment. So many, I mean, you have done, I guess, on the big scale for some time, but particularly on the smaller scale, you know, actors able to produce and direct and to write themselves into things, which I think, I don't know if you agree with this, but I feel like it kind of gives a level of respect or maybe a different way of looking at each other and bridging the gap between the actors and the producers and the directors, because they kind of know and they're more comfortable with their area, if it were.
Yeah, without a shadow of a doubt. And if you look at the amount of young actors now that are writing and producing their own stuff, which is getting made, you know, made, and it's getting made on big platforms like Sky, Amazon, Netflix, you know, and I've just finished a TV series called Brassic, which I literally finished filming a week ago, which was written and devised by a young actor, Joe Gielgan, you know, and he got an established writer, Danny Brocklehurst, on board. But, you know, it was Joe's idea, and Joe is, you know, Joe's also one of the lead actors in it. Yeah. But, you know, there are so many different ways into the industry now for everybody behind the camera and in front of the camera. It's not just a formalized training. And I think the industry is embracing that as well, Ollie.
Yeah, no, definitely. Have you come across any directors that have either done something similar to that recently or?
Yeah, I mean, I've worked with a young director called Matthew Harrison a lot over the last few years. And I did a really nice short film with him called Son of Perdition a few years ago. And I admire Matthew a lot because, you know, he is constantly trying to create a storytelling process. And Son of Perdition was a brilliant little movie, and it was brilliantly shot and well devised. with a very small crew. And, you know, he had another script which he was going to do, which he couldn't get made because we were in lockdown. And so he very cleverly got the cast together and did it as a podcast.
Yeah.
You know, and so at least he was out there getting his story told in some way, shape or form. But, and I've worked with Matthew a lot and I like working with him. And he's a very good young director. And he's very good. You know, he's very clear in his storytelling process and what he wants to do.
Yeah, that's kind of what you need, isn't it? And that's the first step, as you've already mentioned.
Yeah, absolutely. But, you know, I think young filmmakers now, I mean, hey, you know, the sky's the limit. You've just got to go out and try it and write it and do it and shoot it.
Yes.
You know, and nobody needs, you know, the first short films I did years and years ago, you know, you still had to have a pretty large budget. And a pretty big camera and a crew. And we just don't anymore. You know, you can tell that story using any convention. And as I said, you can do it on an iPhone and it'll look pretty good.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, that for us, and particularly for me, has highlighted how, I don't want to say easy it is, because I don't want to say that it's easy getting the whole project together. But how, in essence, how easy it is to actually get some work going, particularly like right now in lockdown. You know, as you know, we've had to take on a whole new category because just the number of entries that we had, our entries started to kind of like drop a little bit at the beginning of lockdown. And then suddenly we had, you know, 40, 50, 60 lockdown kind of related projects come in. And it would kind of seem silly not to create a category for that. And then by the end of sort of June, July, we had so many of them that, and some of those have actually gone into the other categories. And also be shortlisted in those categories because they've really, really shone. So that's absolutely an example of that.
Yeah. I mean, you could actually shoot a short film in lockdown without much problem at all.
Oh, yeah. As long as, I mean,
what's weird is I was watching something the other night on Netflix. It was a series called Criminals. They've done it on one set. You know, so the whole series, I don't know how many episodes it is, but they've got one set. They've got one setup in theory, you know, they've probably got three camera setups in the whole thing. And you know, I watched two or three episodes of it back to back, and I'm pretty sure it must have been started or shot through lockdown because of the way
it's really impressive. Have you been able to keep yourself busy in lockdown?
I mean, obviously, so literally just before lockdown in March, I was shooting a Netflix series called Shadow and Bone, which wrapped literally at the end of March. So I came off that and I was due to hopefully start another series, but then of course we hit lockdown. The fortunate thing for me was financially is that I have a voiceover career. And I very quickly put together I got together a microphone, software, and a recording booth, so that I was able to do some stuff from home. I wasn't doing anywhere near the amount of stuff that I would usually be doing, but at least I was doing something, work-wise and creatively. And also, I do a lot of voices for the gaming industry, and the gaming industry, once again, I was able to record some of that kind of stuff at home. And then coming out of lockdown, I went straight onto the set of Brassic. So, but
which is a bit of an interesting story, is it not? What you have to do now with the regulations in place?
Yeah. So it was a totally COVID-safe set. So it's very strange because you're wearing all your PPE, and the crew are wearing their PPE when you're standing there, and then all of a sudden you take it all off so that you can shoot the scene. And then as soon as they shout cut, you put it all back on again. And everybody's eating their lunch separately and staying 6 feet apart from up until the point someone shouts action.
and COVID just disappears, isn't it?
We were all having two COVID tests a week. You know, they had it all in place. But, you know, it's a fairly big budget production guy. So consequently, you know, they have the money to do it.
Yeah.
But nevertheless, it was still a fairly alien experience in filming.
In fact,
they had to stop it now because one of the crew tested positive. So they've had to take 2 weeks out up until everyone tests negative, and then they start up again.
Wow.
But it was nice to get back. It was nice to get back on a set and be working, really.
No, absolutely. Absolutely. I mean, obviously, you've got your agent who's kind of giving you information as you're going, but was there a way in which you were kind of able to kind of stay in the know as kind of what the other colleagues and guys you worked before, friends who are actors, what they've been doing? Or did you just kind of sit back for a bit and just wait and then kind of get rolling?
No, I mean, I just, you know, I'm hooked onto a whole bunch of stuff on social media that tells me what's going on.
Okay.
And in fact, there was a couple of times I saw some stuff, you know, during the lockdown where people had been off doing certain series that were made specifically for lockdown. And I was just getting very jealous that I wasn't in one of them, really. So, but no, so on social media, I'm hooked into a lot of filmmakers and TV stuff and casting directors, you know, so I was kind of keeping abreast of what was going on really as much as I could. But it does give you a huge frustration when you kind of see things and you see productions that were going to go that now are not going. And so it was a very frustrating time for everybody. But I did keep as hooked into it as I could, Ollie.
I mean, I guess this kind of leads us up to my next question, actually. And I appreciate we could be here for hours between you and I talking about this. But kind of in summary, how are you feeling about how the industry has either been treated or has treated itself, and how the government has kind of treated the industry in the last couple of months?
I mean,
you okay about it, or
I was lucky, and I qualified for some kind of self-employed help during the lockdown, but there are thousands upon thousands of people who have slipped right through the cracks, just because they don't fulfill a certain criteria. And that is people who work in the theatre industry, in the film industry, in the television industry, who have slipped through the cracks. So have basically had nothing at all. I mean, off the subject of films, if we were talking about theatre, I mean, I think that has been woefully under-assisted by the government.
Yeah. No, it has.
You know, there is a whole industry which is failing very rapidly there. And for obvious reasons, because of audiences, you know, cannot possibly recover. But I mean, you know, it begs the question, if you can have, you know, a few hundred people sitting on an aircraft, you can't have a few hundred people sitting in a theater. I don't know, you know, how does that work?
For sure.
Surely, you know.
Absolutely.
So I think that in general, in the industry, you know, I mean, the Chancellor made a comment the other day, basically saying that the arts weren't viable. And so in which case, in my opinion, if that's the case, in which case that means during the next, if there's another lockdown, don't watch Netflix, don't watch Amazon.
I saw you share that on social media like that. Yeah. And that sums it up really. Too much of a whole on all of that. On a lighter note, the gaming, the voiceovers. So the gaming world, let's start with that, because that's, I guess, a little bit closer to what some of our audience will be doing and kind of have an understanding on how that makes a difference, things like that. So what games have you kind of done recently? What's that like? And how do you kind of feel that it'll kind of influence the industry as we move forward?
I mean, I think, you know, the gaming industry and the way they tell stories and the way those stories are interactive. I mean, I did one last year, which was called Blood and Truth for Sony, which was VAR and interactive. So basically you're kind of in the scene with the actors, which was really quite unbelievable. And I know that there are companies looking into whether or not you can do something similar on film and on television, that the viewer is in fact part of your storytelling process and your plot process. Not particularly in a game sense, but in an interactive viewing sense. And also, you know, the way these games are filmed, which is with the motion capture, performance capture, is hugely bleeding into the way that films are now made.
Yeah.
And I'm sure it will bleed into the short film industry as well. I have no doubt whatsoever. Mm-hmm. And it is a fascinating way of storytelling. I mean, for me as an actor, it was a whole, absolutely whole new ballgame, because it's almost like operating in a sterile environment with no props, no costume, no makeup.
Yeah.
Occasionally, no fellow actors. Mm-hmm. Just you in a huge studio
making loads of different movements and
with a camera on your head and a lycra suit.
Yeah,
and trust me, no one of my age wants to be wearing a lycra suit.
Nobody. Sure pull it off.
Anthony Joshua looks good in a lycra suit. I don't look good in a lycra suit, but you know, they're pretty exposing. But from an actor's point of view, it's almost like a pure form of acting, because it's almost like being in your bedroom when you were a kid and creating your own story. You know, so you're just in a kind of fairly sterile environment with people on computer screens in front of you and cameras all around you and a camera on your head, with no outside stimulus whatsoever.
No.
You know, so someone's just saying, okay, you're on a battleship, a space cruiser, and there's 50 stormtroopers coming through the door after you, away you go. excuse me. But I'm sure the way that is filmed, and also it's going to bleed into the film industry as well. It already
is. No, yeah, it has. Yeah, for sure. And voiceovers? Obviously,
I've done a couple of gaming voiceovers for new games this week. I'm not allowed to say what the games are.
All right.
I have to sign one of those disclaimer things until the game comes out. But I did a couple of those this week. And then, oddly enough, today I've just done a voice test for another new game, which... but I don't think they're even going to start recording.
Right,
so early 2021. And so, but yes, so they kind of keep me going, fortunately, and it is an industry for actors that is opening right up, you know, in performance and also, not in only voice performance, but also in performance capture and motion capture.
For sure. I remember when I was at drama school, I had a conversation with one of the teachers who, I mean, he's done a lot of stuff, worked at the West End, done loads of work. I actually didn't really know much about the game. I had a conversation with him, and then he suddenly was kind of like, oh, that's kind of available now.
Yeah.
Like, you see that the kind of, his eyes just kind of be like, oh, cool, like I'll try and get on top of that and as and when I can.
Absolutely. I mean, the gaming industry for me has been 35% of my work or 40% of my work for the last couple of years.
Yeah.
And it's a huge opportunity for young actors and probably young filmmakers as well, to get into that industry, because all it is really ultimately is another storytelling process. That's all, you know, that's what it is.
Mm-hmm.
Albeit from a gaming point of view, it's an interactive storytelling process. But nevertheless, it is a storytelling process. And as I said, they are looking at using similar processes on television and in film as well. There's a subject for a short film right there, without a doubt.
Definitely. On just kind of reading it back to the festival itself, just because we're literally closing in on time. Obviously you've said that it was tight. I don't want you to name any favourites or give anything away. But kind of out of the top three, was there anything that stood out to you that you felt was different to something else, whether it be kind of a more heartfelt story or...
Well, am I allowed to name the film?
It was
incredibly close this year.
Yeah.
I mean, it was absolutely incredibly close. In terms of storytelling, I loved the way Scrabble, the story was told in Scrabble. I really liked it. I thought that was a brilliant piece of storytelling. I really did. And the revelation at the end of storytelling was a kind of really heartrending revelation as well.
Yes.
And I was really impressed with that storytelling. I mean, you know, there was a top three films that were just really, really close, as you know.
Mm-hmm.
And
even the top five. The top five.
Absolutely.
We had to have a cutoff point, but for fiction, the top five was, and pretty much all the other categories, there was one or two points in between the winners and kind of fifth and sixth. So, yeah.
Yeah. I mean, absolutely. It was ridiculously close. And, you know, in a way, it was actually very, very hard to judge because, and certainly the films that I know are in the top three, all three of those films, you know, really, it could have gone any way
without a doubt.
There was nothing between them.
Those are the people that don't know, it was out of 40 possible points. So the fact that it was, you know, 1 point dividing the top three to five.
Yeah, absolutely. And not only that, the other thing, which I think is important to say, is that, you know, sometimes there has been vast difference in production values and budgets, and that was not apparent this year. You know, sometimes I think when judging the film festival and when judging shorts, I am always very, very aware that there is, there can often be vast discrepancies within the budget, and I don't let that sway me. I'm still looking at the story, the content, and the way the story has been told.
Fantastic.
You know, and trust me, I've seen short films that have been made on big budgets, but they may look great, but there's big holes in the stories, or it relies too much on coincidence, there are holes in the story, or it just doesn't add up. So whereas you can get a low budget, which is a beautifully told and truthful story, and it all adds up.
Yeah.
I mean, any young filmmaker, you know, my advice to them is you need to look at that story and make that story believable.
Yes.
You know, however you are choosing to tell the story. And, you know, because often if you've got 90 or 120 minutes, you can rely on a bit of coincidence perhaps, or a bit of implausibility. But if you've got 15 minutes to tell your story, you've got to make sure that that story's holding water and it's truthful.
Absolutely. We do have a question from the audience.
Okay.
They want to cut us off. I just know that people will be obviously keen to see their work kind of shining. So we've got one. Hi, Steve. Can you tell me what the most challenging role has been and why?
Oh, that's tricky. It depends on the medium, to be perfectly honest, you know, because there are some theatre roles that I found incredibly challenging. I mean, you know, I played Bill Sykes in the musical Oliver, and I'm not a great singer, and I had to sing in front of 3,000 people at the London Palladium and at Drury Lane. So trust me, that was challenging as far as I was concerned. But it's very difficult to say because it purely depends on how far away that role is from you as a person as well. Or maybe the shoot is a challenging environment.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, there are many different kind of variables involved in what makes a role challenging. So it's quite a difficult one to say, really. You know, on film, I did a short film, funnily enough, called Deserter, which was a great little film. But it was a very challenging shoot in terms of the locations and the environments that we were in. It was really, really difficult. And it was kind of, you know, cold and wet and muddy and all that kind of stuff. And so trying to keep it together in that environment was really, really hard. You know, so it's a kind of, there's a lot of variables in what actually makes a role challenging. It's not just the amount of screen time or the amount of dialogue. You know, it's there's a whole bunch of variables involved in it.
Sure.
Doing the motion capture on Blood and Truth, the VAR, was incredibly challenging. And
by yourself.
purely because of the lack of outside influence on it, and that it is all in your own head and your own imagination.
Yeah, no, of course. We are over time, but do you want to say anything to any of the directors? Is there anything you would like to I mean, you've already said.
No, I'd just like to say thank you very much for everybody that put films in this year. And thank you very much, you know, for your work and the quality of your work. And, you know, for many, many, you know, long ago, short films were looked at as the poor relation to 90-minute, 120-minute movies. They're not. It's a medium in its own right, a storytelling medium in its own right, and is becoming more and more recognized as such. It is no longer the poor relation to larger filmmaking.
No,
short films, it's an important medium, and don't forget that.
Yeah. Perfect. Thank you so much, Steve.
Thanks,
Ollie. I hope everybody kind of takes that on. We've had really good interaction as well from all of our directors this year. Everyone's been, you know, really, really happy to have kind of been involved and really happy with us kind of doing this way. So yeah, thank you as well to you and all the other judges, and everyone will see their results tomorrow.
Yeah.
Which I'm sure will be good fun. Actually, we've got quite a lot of people turning up for, which is good. Okay, cool. So we're going to close that off here.